Let's talk about macros. Now, there are two ways to view macros, in my opinion. There's the user side of macros and there's the author side of macros. We're mostly going to talk about the user side of macros today, or how you would view macros if you were just going to use them. From that perspective, we have basically three different kinds of macros in Rust. The first one is something that looks a lot like a function when you use it. In this case, we're using println. We know it's a macro because of the exclamation point, and then we call it much like we did any other function. If I run the Tokyo example here, we get did it one, did it two, did it three, all printed out, which is exactly what the println macro is doing for us. The second kind of macro that we'll talk about today is called an attribute macro. That's this Tokyo main attribute decorator at the top. Basically, this is a macro that you can place on an item. So in this case, this macro is being applied to this async function. Items are well-defined in the Rust docs, but for now, you can basically think of it as anything, for lack of a better phrasing. Some examples include modules, use declarations, function definitions, type definitions, struct definitions, and so on and so forth. Items encompass a lot of things in the Rust AST. And the third macro that we're going to talk about today is a derive macro. And these are called in similar way to attribute macros, but they use this derive at the beginning here. And then the derive macros themselves are specified inside of that sort of what looks like almost a derive function call. So let's start out with the one that you're probably more familiar with, the function call macro. Because I have Rust Analyzer installed in VS Code, I can use Rust Analyzer to expand this macro recursively. So what I've done here is placed my cursor on this print line macro and then asked Rust Analyzer to expand that and show it to us. So you can think of macros as code generation, more or less. In this case, this print line macro expands to a block that calls a print function that takes a new V1 function call with some arguments. The code in here isn't too important. I just wanted to point out basically that function call like macros expand into completely readable Rust code. That's because the symbols or the tokens or the stuff that we put inside of the function call itself needs to be valid Rust syntax. And then we transform that into some other valid Rust syntax. So we haven't actually gotten to any, there's no assembly in here. There's no like deep AST magic in here yet. It's just taking whatever we put in and outputting some function call. If we're really curious, we can make it all the way into the Rustlang Rust repo and do a search for new V1 and eventually make it to the function definition for new V1, including some additional documentation that may or may not help us. But understanding what's actually being generated on this level isn't necessary, even though it is fully accessible and you can go to the Rustlang Rust repo and find where it is and read it if you want to. So if the println macro expands to just some code, what does the Tokyo main macro do? Well, we can expand this attribute macro as well. If we do, we can see a fairly direct correspondence between the two pieces of code. We've got our async function main with three do thing calls that are awaited. It's important to note that async function main is not a supported async function in Rust. Your main function has to be synchronous. So this Tokyo main attribute macro has to rewrite that into a synchronous main function. Then we specify the body of the function that we're going to use or the code that we want to actually execute. And we wrap that in an async block itself so that we can still await everything. We name that async block. So you can kind of think of this as like a closure if you're not familiar with block scoping yet. The code we see right here is just some clippy linting. It's not super important. When you do generation of code, you kind of don't want people to be warned about things that they have no control over. So this is used to explicitly allow a couple of things. And then finally, inside of our synchronous main function, we instantiate a new Tokyo runtime using the builder API. In this case, we have a new multi-thread runtime. We enable a bunch of features, we build it, we make sure that it succeeded because, you know, if it didn't succeed, then our program can't run. And then we block on the execution of this async body block, which in turn executes each of our functions, awaits them, and then returns. So that's how we get each of our functions on the left running. Now, attribute macros can also accept what I'll call arguments. So let's copy this into a new file and let's get rid of this expansion. And on the left-hand side here, We've called this attribute macro kind of as a function call. It's not really a function call, but we pass in worker threads equals 10. So notice what happens on the right-hand side when we do that. If I click in here and I swap between them, there's not much difference, even though I'm swapping quite rapidly, right? It's only this one function call here, this worker threads 10 usize that gets added. Now, I particularly like the Tokyo main call as a example for macros because the Tokyo runtime is made to be able to be constructed regularly. You're supposed to be able to use it, right? It's not something that we're using a macro to hide away forever. It's something that we're using a macro to make easier in the vast majority of use cases. In this case, they call those use cases simple use cases, which is true because we don't get as much configuration capability as we do of getting the actual builder ourselves and then writing the code. But if you go to the Tokyo docs and you read what the Tokyo main attribute macro does to a given piece of code, they also give you the equivalent code to build this up yourself. And you can see that this is exactly the same code that we just saw. It's a little bit different because the macro, of course, generates the additional clippy lints and things like that. But this is the exact same code we just had. We block on an async block and we do some stuff inside of it. So in this case, the attribute macro for Tokyo main isn't necessarily because we can't write this code, but more because we don't need to write this code for a number of common use cases. Like, you will use Tokyo main as an attribute macro in a great many of your applications if you're working in, say, serverless functions. And bootstrapping the new runtime all the time is kind of tiring. So it's just kind of a nice utility that can infer the arguments that we give it and write out the correct runtime code so that we don't have to worry about having not written the runtime initialization code correctly. Now, just because we can write the Tokyo main code ourselves doesn't mean that all macros are like that. And specifically, derived macros tend to have more code in them. And Serde specifically, the crate that we're about to look at, is a quite complicated crate internally. So in this case, we've got the serialize and deserialize derived macros, as well as the debug macro. If we run this code, we get a serialized version of this point, which has an X and a Y, and a deserialized version of the point, which has the point struct with the X and the Y in it. That's what the code in main is doing right now. But we don't particularly care about the code in main right now. Let's take a look at what this derived macro looks like when we expand it, because we can expand any macro that we want to. And immediately we find out that this code is, you know, a little bit more complicated. It's got a little bit more going on than the Tokyo code. For example, the serialized derived macro implements its own try macro that it then uses later on. So yeah, you can actually define macros that write macros up to, if I remember correctly, it's like 30 levels of macro nesting. Now, 30 levels is obviously a bit extreme and you don't really want to do that unless you absolutely have to, but macros are extremely flexible. Now, 30 lines is quite a bit and, you know, it's not fun to write that. But if we look at the deserialized macro, we get almost 150 lines of code out of that. Again, we have some similar idioms, like the deserialized macro defines its own try macro using macro rules and then generates the implementation for deserialized for our point. And this code is just code that is going to be the same for everything that ever gets deserialized for given type. So there's no reason for us as the person who is implementing serialized or deserialized to have to rewrite this code for any number of structs that might all be using like U8 deserialization code or a string or a vec or whatever it is. So in this case, the serialize and deserialize derived macros can be implemented manually, but quite often in even more probably use cases than the Tokyo main macro, these are used in a way that gives us this derive, but produces almost 200 lines of code between them. Now, from the user side perspective, we've gone over function macros, attribute macros, and derive macros. From the authoring side, there's basically only two macro types. There's macros that you define with macro rules, and there's something called procedural macros, when we go into authoring macros on this channel and exploring what that looks like, we're going to start with macro rules, which you can see the syntax for right here. We've got macro rules with the name of our macro and a block. And then this is basically matching on whatever expressions we can put inside of try and then doing something with those. In this case, it's quite noisy because macros are embedded in the space in which they are executing. So what we want to do here is actually make sure that the module paths that we're referring to aren't going to be defined in the user's file. So in this case, we're basically matching on whatever expression it is. If it's okay, then we do this. We just return whatever value it is. And if it's an error, then we return an error. So when it comes down to this, if we copy this out and I create a new file quickly, I'll delete all of the extra stuff here. And we can see now that I've removed a lot of that extra cruft, a lot of that extra module pathing, that this is just generating a match function for whether something is okay or something is an error. And we've seen match functions before. So all that means is that there's some expression that we're matching on. And if you've used match before, you know that match can match on many different kinds of expressions. And whether it's okay and has a value, we return that. Or if it's an error, then we return an error. So macro rules then is used for simple macros like this. Whereas procedural macros are much more heavyweight. They are functions that take token streams in, or what you can think of almost as an AST, but it's not an AST. And then they output different token streams that get written into the source file. So one more time, what we're looking at here is the expanded code that is generated by the macro. We aren't looking at the macro definition itself. That is going to be a different video. All this is looking at what code was generated for our type because we wanted to derive it. And those are the three types of Rust macro. Again, you kind of see println and function-like macros all over the place. Tokyo and Saturday are both very popular libraries, so you'll very often see this Tokyo main attribute macro, which will rewrite this main function for us, or one of these derived macros, which will automatically generate implementations for various traits that we need or want to exist. And very often, these traits are also implementable manually. Although in the Tokyo case, we can see that that is significantly easier than in the Saturday case, which may take more code and more understanding of what Saturday is doing internally. So I hope that helped a little bit more about macros. If you missed the first video on macros and why we need them, I'll link that in the description. And I hope you enjoyed this video. Have a great rest of your day.